Thank you very much, and thank you, Jim, for the introduction. And I'd also like to start off by thanking the organizers of the conference. It's been a really interesting couple of days so far, and looking forward to telling you more about DFA and what we do. So these two maps, I don't know if people are familiar with these types of maps. There's a whole lot of them at this website, worldmapper.org. But I think this gives a really nice overview of the problem that we're trying, at least in part, to address here. And that is the disparity between public healthcare spending and areas of the world that are afflicted by infectious disease and parasitic deaths. So what this does is basically takes a particular statistic and it will inflate the size of a country or region in proportion to that statistic. So you can see the global map of public healthcare spending. You can still pick on the United States is gigantic fat bubble here, and you can see Africa here looks like a deflated balloon, and India, same thing, Southeast Asia. But if you correlate that to looking at what regions of the world are most affected by infectious disease, these are largely curable and treatable diseases, and parasitic deaths, you can see barely recognize the U.S. here, and Africa is gigantic, India is gigantic. So the problem that we're looking at here is there's a huge disparity between spending and technology development in regions that people desperately need it, and that's largely because there's a perceived lack of a market there. And I like this quote from Bill Gates here as a provocative thought to you know, everybody in technology development on, you know, thinking about the end result of technologies and the impact that they have. So when we think about technology development in the developing world in particular, there's a number of challenges that arise, and these are technical challenges, they're engineering problems. We have patients that are living in a highly decentralized region, highly decentralized healthcare system, very different from the healthcare systems that we in the West and in the developed world enjoy, where you can go to a hospital, you have very expensive instruments and medications and highly trained physicians. The developing world, it's all locally distributed. You're often working with healthcare workers who have minimal training. Any diagnostic device needs to be portable and disposable. Oftentimes you don't have follow-up, so if you're dealing with a diagnostic in particular, it needs to be actionable. So we have this word actionable, which means that someone needs to be able to make a clinical decision at the point of care within 20 minutes to maybe a few hours, depending on the area. So you really need to get as much information as you possibly can from that one visit. Phlebotomy is a fancy word for blood draw. Is difficult, so oftentimes the equipment to do that is unavailable, so you're dealing with finger sticks, which are easier to get a hold of. Cold storage, electricity are there in some regions and others not, so it's not reliably present. And then at the end of the day, you know, cost is everything, so any technology that is going to be used and adapted in the developing world needs to be very, very inexpensive. And so we have this statement here at the bottom, basically that we don't want to take a current healthcare or a modern instrument and try to take parts out of it or make it cheaper, because it's still, that instrument is still working in a centralized healthcare model. What we need is new technologies and new solutions starting from the ground up, and that's what I'm hoping to tell you a little bit about today and what we're doing with paper. So there's a couple of great talks yesterday, and you know, the themes about looking for new uses for printing, new uses for paper. And this is exactly what I think what we're doing here. So just mainly looking at three technologies. We have printing, paper, and then new ways of generating and thinking about color. And how do we combine all of these things and transform them into medical information, in particular medical information for areas that can't afford current technologies. So I'll talk a little bit about this, and then a very important concept that I'm not showing here is the digitization of this medical information, in particular with colors and with devices. So I'll talk a little bit about that, but that is an area of immense interest to us as well. So just an outline, I'm going to give a quick introduction to Diagnostics for All, who we are, what our technology is, our business model, and then I'll go over in very high level different capabilities and different areas that we have with the pattern paper platform. And then I'll go into a few examples. I'll spend the most time on our liver function test because that is our lead product. I'll talk a little bit about immunoassay, and then we have a new program in nucleic acid diagnostics, so looking at PCR-like technology at dramatically low cost. So we're very excited about that. I'll show you a little bit of that and then wrap up. So just a little bit about us. We are a not-for-profit 501c3 organization. We're located in Cambridge, Mass., just about 20 minutes from Harvard University. We were founded in 2007, but really didn't get fully staffed until about 2010. We have 13 full-time employees and a large volunteer staffs ranging from students and engineers, business development folks, clinical folks. And so we are very small, we're still in very early stage, but that also means we can move very quickly. So we are always interested in partnering and talking to people in diagnostics and printing and manufacturing. And then our technology platform, again, really we're looking to do new things with paper. And paper is a very fascinating material. It has a number of very interesting properties that are relevant in diagnostics and in other areas. And everything that we do ultimately comes down to being able to pattern paper. So being able to pattern hydrophobic barriers into the paper. And the important part here is that these barriers are throughout the thickness of the paper. And that's how we're able to control wicking. So everyone knows a familiar example, you spill wine or coffee on a paper towel and it will wick out indiscriminately. And by having patterns present in the porous media, we can direct the flow of fluids and also have it pick up chemistries. We can perform a number of fluidic operations. We can have dwell times. We can have mixing, splitting, all the things that you can do with a traditional microfluidic device we're doing in paper. And so, as you know, paper is ubiquitous. It's very, very low in cost. And I'm sort of broadly defining paper as thin, porous media, just to clarify that. We use a range of materials to make our devices. It's also not uncommon to find paper in biological labs. There's a long history in Western blots and lateral flow devices of spotting antibodies and reagents down on paper and using them for various assays. Fluids are readily wicked, and importantly, this without pumps. If anybody's worked in microfluidics, it's always very frustrating because you go to great lengths to make this incredibly cool, tiny chip with all these features on it, and then you put it in a table that's, you know, the size of a room with microscopes and syringe pumps and all these things feeding fluids into it. And so the paper technology avoids the use of these syringe pumps to drive fluids through. So that's all done by wicking, and that's a really key part of what we can do. All you have to do is add the sample, and the device takes over from there. Again, no strangers here to that you can print on paper. It's easily patterned. There's a host of industries built around handling paper and manufacturing it. The high surface area of paper and porous materials lends itself nicely to reagent storage, to have chemistries release when you want them to and readily mix with your analyte. And this idea of paper being stackable, so it's thin, so you can stack multiple layers of patterned paper. And by doing that, you can really begin to make some interesting devices that aren't just low in cost, but also are sophisticated and can perform fluidic operations and multiplexed assays. And I'll talk about that in a few slides. And so from this one simple concept of really just putting hydrophobic barriers, and these barriers can be wax, they can be polymers, it can be really anything. There's a range of printing techniques to do this. I'll highlight one in particular. From this simple concept, you can really, your imagination can run wild on the different architectures and different types of devices you can build. And so we're exploiting this technology to make new diagnostics. Our business model, ultimately, we want to build a sustainable not-for-profit organization, so not one that's solely relying on charitable donations or grants for its existence. We recognize that this technology and the technology platform is can be used to make products here in the developed world and make for-profit, work with for-profit companies, you know, in a range of areas where there's a lot of money to be made. So we want to take advantage of that and use those revenues to feed the not-for-profit mission. And so that's ultimately here. We are able to sub-license the technology. We're able to do deals like any other small biotech would. This, I won't spend too much time here, but this is our product pipeline. And again, these are largely tests that are being funded by grants for us to develop. We have a lot of funding from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and also a couple of grants from the Department of Defense and one grant from USAID. But you can see there's a range of different tests in both human and animal health. We have a great agriculture program funded by the Gates Foundation to develop tests that help rural farmers. So developing the ideas to you know, create a more reliable food source, but also help local microeconomies. So if you can have small diagnostic tests that can tell bovine pregnancy, for example, that it's greatly useful to a dairy farmer in Africa. So we have a number of tests for human health. Our most advanced is the liver function test. I'll spend a few slides on that. And we've just finished up our first field study for that test in Vietnam. Okay, so now we're going to walk through just broad strokes of capabilities, very high level, but just give you an example of all the different types of things that we can do with this relatively simple platform. So what we really see ourselves is positioned to have an impact in, you know, the four major areas of diagnostics, sort of dividing this up into clinical chemistry assays. So these are largely enzymatic assays that can be tailored to produce a color. Our liver function test is an example of that. So these work with enzymes and color-producing dyes that can give a range across a clinical range, different colors. Immunoassays, so based on antigen, antibody binding, or antibody binding. So we have a number of programs that are actively using that. One of the really important things that we can do here in immunoassays is to do panels, so to do multiplexed panels of a number of different diseases simultaneously from a small drop of blood or urine. And so this fever panel is something that our latest project actually where you want to be able to test for a number of fever-causing illnesses, not just do you have malaria or do you not have malaria, but if you don't have malaria, what do you have? And again, back to that point about trying to get as much information as you can from that single patient visit. We can also pattern electrodes on top of pattern paper and build electrochemical devices that have both, so now we have paper microfluidics combined with electrochemical detection. And so we can do a number of things in cases where quantitative, there are cases where quantitative analysis is necessary and you do need to get a number ultimately. And so I'll show a little bit of that. And then molecular diagnostics is the latest field here, and this is really the future of diagnostics. And our approach has been to how do we leverage some of these amplification techniques and incredibly low sensitivities that one is able to achieve with nucleic acid diagnostics. How do we leverage that in our platform and dramatically reduce the cost of this, not using it in an instrument that costs $100,000? And again, a really important idea here is that the unique properties of this platform allow for multiplex combinations to be built. So this is a printing conference. Of course, we have to talk about printing. Our current method that we use to pattern paper is actually using the Xerox Color Cube. And Paul McConville from Xerox gave a really great talk on this technology yesterday, particularly the large scale platform. We really love this technology and for a number of reasons. One, it's very, very cheap. On a per device basis, you basically get the paper and the patterning of your device for free. All the end cost in your diagnostic is going to come from your reagents, like your antibodies, and you know your manufacturing costs and labor costs and things like that. So it dramatically reduces the cost of making these devices. It is highly scalable. As Paul walked through yesterday, the new CyPress unit can run 500 feet per minute, I believe is the speed, and that's more than enough to make millions of devices. And so the way this works, we simply design a pattern on the computer using Adobe Illustrator or CAD software. You just simply print the devices, just like you would print a document for the office. Initially, the wax is deposited on the surface of the paper. And then what we do, and this is described in detail here from this paper from the Whitesides lab here, we just heat it. So you heat it above the melting temperature of the wax. You get a very low viscosity achieved at pretty high temperatures. And that's important because you don't want the wax melting if you're, you know, in a hot desert. It's nowhere close to the temperature, you know, that it's required to melt the wax. It's around 130 C is what we usually do. And so that will, you know, melt this wax, and then it permeates throughout the thickness of the paper, and that's how we define a channel. So you can see here we have this pitchfork pattern. We've now defined a channel, and you can flow a fluid, and it will stay within the confines of those wax barriers. Another really important advantage of this is very, very rapid prototyping. So being able to go through device designs and different channel widths and different device architectures very quickly is important. If you've ever worked in traditional microfluidics field, you're going into the clean room, you're doing photolithography to make masters. Here, all you have to do is change it on the computer and hit print. So it's very, very straightforward for prototyping. It's very fast. So that's my plug for wax printing. So 3D devices, so I talked a lot about multiplexing. This is how we do this. And this comes from being able to stack layers of patterned paper. So what I'm showing here in gray, that would be a layer of patterned paper. So the gray would be the wax, and then the color would be where we still have untouched paper that can wick. And then in between each of these layers, we have a layer of pattern adhesive. And so this can be a really thin die-cut double-sided tape, or this could be a screen-printed adhesive is another way to do this. But the important thing is that we have a hydrophobic adhesive with a hole in it, basically, that allows for fluidic connection in the Z direction. So I can have X and Y in my sheet of paper, and then I can drop to the next layer in the Z direction. And so by doing this and by thinking about different patterns, I can begin to split my sample, and that's a really important concept, especially when you're dealing with multiplexing. So if you just follow this blue drop, I put it in the top, it flows through this hole in the adhesive, flows laterally through this channel and this second layer of paper, then drops down to this third layer of paper where it's split four times. Each of those endpoints then drops down to another layer where they're split four times, and so on and so forth. So from a single fluidic input, I quickly get 16 different outputs. So I have a sample that's now split in reproducible volumes 16 times, and I can add other colors here just showing that I can do this in a pretty small area. And so this is done with about 30 microliters of fluid, which is about the volume that you'd get from a finger stick. So this is just food coloring, and I'll show you later how we've transformed this into actual assays. And then we can take this a step further. We can make cards or with a few more sample inputs. In this case, it's 8 sample inputs. We can now have hundreds. I believe this is over 500 sample outputs. So you can begin to think about, you know, a number of assays, doing reproducible standards, all sorts of things. And then we can do this with channels where we can have channels run underneath each other and either mix or not mix when we want them to. So electrochemical detection, as I talked about, sometimes it is useful to have a specific number at a quantitative assay. And so we do this by combining the patterned paper with patterned electrodes. For this, we can just use simple screen printing of conductive inks like silver chloride or carbon. And one of the some really interesting work that's especially come out of the Whitesides lab is to build paper-based devices that can fit inside of low-cost digital readers like a glucometer. So this is a glucometer from CVS. It costs about $5. And by building a paper device that fits into it and tweaking the chemistry that is laid down on the paper, you can begin to do assays outside of glucose, all for very low cost and still be able to get quantitative information from it. And so right now they're working on extending this into immunoassays and a number of really interesting things. So I mentioned digitization, and one of the really interesting ways to do this is through telemedicine. This is taking advantage of the fact that cell phones are ubiquitous throughout the developing world, especially in Africa and India. They've basically, you know, skipped over the landline infrastructure and gone straight to wireless and cell phone communication. And so one of the things we're really interested in is digitizing and quantifying color, and for storage and for interpretation. And so there's basically two broad ways to do this. I'm sure you can think of a number of others. But one would be if you have a very, you know, an old phone with a simple camera on it, not a smartphone, but you can snap a picture of a colorimetric assay. You can basically text that to an offsite facility where you have image analysis software that can do corrections and interpretation of that color. And so there's another paper that here describing that. But increasingly, I think, you know, this will be the way things go, where everything's just done on the phone. And so you can see here, this is an array of color, and these little red squares here are recognition elements built into the software of the phone, where it can actually recognize a color, correct for it with a printed calibration standard, and then give you a quantitative answer. So we're incredibly excited about this, and you know, we do see this as sort of a complement to our technology, where the device is providing the medical information, and the phone becomes your interpretation and storage device. So I'll start with the first example of a specific test that we're developing, and this is our liver function test. So the problem that we're trying to address here, it actually starts with something that's a positive thing, which is that there is increased access to antiretroviral therapy for patients in the developing world who are being treated for HIV. There's increased access to other medications for tuberculosis. But the problem is those patients don't live in areas that have the infrastructure to monitor side effects. And so there's an increasing problem of people becoming sick from the medications they're taking, not from the diseases they have. And so what we were asked to develop, this is a Gates-funded program, we were asked to develop a simple paper-based test that can monitor liver enzymes. These two enzymes, AST and ALT, are found in the bloodstream in patients that are experiencing hepatotoxicity. And so, you know, what the goal here is not to measure these enzymes to, you know, the fifth decimal point and quantify it to an unnecessary degree, but can you make a device that says they're in the normal range, they're elevated, or they're highly elevated? And so that's what we set out to do. And this is what our device looks like. So we work from a simple finger stick from a lancet. It requires about 30 microliters of blood. We have a blood cell filter on the back of the device. So the blood is applied, the cells are filtered out, and then the plasma wicks through the paper to these detection zones. And so these are the two assays. We have ALT here on the left and AST on the right. And then each assay has built-in controls. So we have positive and negative controls for both assays that let you know that the sample is in good condition, the sample has enough volume, and that the test is still working, that all the chemistry is still valid. And so ALT goes from this yellow color in the normal range to a deep red color in the highly elevated range, and then the AST assay goes from a blue color to a pink color. And we do all this with these cascades of chemical reactions that I won't get into. But ultimately, we are talking here about printing, and we're talking about color, and eventually digitizing this color. I'm just going to go through this a little bit quick, but each of these spots serves a very specific function on the device. Again, the ALT test, normal will show up as yellow, elevated will show up as red, and AST normal is blue, and elevated is pink. And these are controls, again, that let you know that the sample is in good shape. One example of this that can occur with some frequency, sort of, you know, in 5% of samples, you might get hemolysis, which means that you have red cells that are lysing. And so what that can do is to release a red color into your test zone, which will obviously throw off, especially the ALT assay. So this spot here basically is an indicator of that. If that spot is yellow, then there's no hemolysis, the test is working, or the sample is fine. But if you see an orange or red color there, then you know you need to redo the test. So just little simple things like this can inform the user, provide information and feedback to the user about the test. So again, this is a printing conference, so I want to talk a little bit about how we manufacture these. So we start with the wax printing. That's then heated, as I discussed. We screen print our adhesive. The LFT is has two layers of pattern paper and then two layers of laminate, and the blood cell filter as well. So we screen print adhesive. We spot our reagents. We use a BioDot robotic spotter for this. I think you could also easily do this with inkjet printing technology, but the BioDot works particularly well for us. We then have a simple jig for alignment, where we align the two layers of paper. We die cut our filters, transfer them to the lamination. Everything is sandwiched together, laminated, and then cut and packaged. And so right now we just do things at a small scale in our facility, so we can make about 500 devices in a day. And so that's enough to get through, you know, a lot of field tests and clinical trials and things like that. But you see that we've chosen techniques and manufacturing processes that are highly, highly scalable, that could be used to make tens of millions of devices when we get to that point. Just a summary of where we are with the tests. We've done a number of testing, a lot of testing with clinical blood specimens, clinical serum specimens, just to get things like linear range and CVs, limits of detection. These are all things that diagnostics people worry about. Stability, we have encountered some issues with that, but we've solved them by changing the chemistry, by putting down special additives with the chemistry, so we can achieve greater than 12-month stability, which is pretty good, and that's about where you want to be, and this is under accelerated conditions, so you kind of stress the test a little bit with heat. We also evaluated interfering factors, just again, things that the providers need to be aware of. And we've initiated, or we're in the process of completing, actually, a field test, a field study in Ho Chi Minh City in Vietnam, and this has been a multi-organization collaboration with Beth Israel Hospital in Boston, PATH, and the Hospital for Tropical Diseases. So just a little bit about that. This is actually a really terrific site, because what we want to do is compare our test to the state of the art. And this particular hospital is it's in a semi-developing world setting, in that it's open, there's no air conditioning, it's incredibly hot and incredibly humid. So we get to get those factors of our test stressed, but we can also compare to state of the art instrumentation. It's at an HIV clinic, so the patients here are HIV positive. They're being treated with antiretrovirals. And on top of that, there's about a 50% co-infection with hepatitis. And so there's about 10 to 20% of the patients will be in that upper bin of elevated liver enzymes. So it's a terrific place for us to go and kind of test, you know, do a field study and make sure that the test can not only be interpreted by us who made it and who are experts at reading it, but by a trained nurse shown here, that they can read and interpret the test and perform it. So again, this is all working with just a simple finger stick added to the back of the device, and then read and interpret the color, and that's compared to a read guide that we provide. So we should have data for this coming down at the end of this month, and we'll hopefully put together a nice publication on that. So the second example I want to talk about is an immunoassay, and so immunoassays are, that's the primary technique that you can use to monitor for infectious disease, to look for the presence of antibodies or for the presence of antigens from a pathogen. So again, though we're dealing with multiple layers of paper. I'm not showing the adhesive here, just for simplicity. But so here we're looking at, we have to do some slightly different functions. We have to release stored reagents here. And then we also wanted to build in an incubation time. So each one of these layers has an analog in a traditional lateral flow test. So the most common example of this would be a home pregnancy test. And the way you do it, an incubation time and a lateral flow test, is just to simply make it longer. And so by using printing, actually, we can make slightly hydrophobic zones in the vertical channel of our 3D device. And that allows you to have a programmable incubation time. So we can have something anywhere from 30 seconds to 20 minutes just sort of sit there and before it begins to wick through to the next layer. And then we have a wash channel at the end. And so the device is designed that you add your sample, you peel it open, you wait a period of time, peel it open, and then read it and look for the presence or absence of a spot. So let's walk through a little more detail. So we have our sample is added here. So we have antigen in this case coming from the sample, and we have latex coated or antibody coated latex beads or antibody coated colloidal gold beads. Basically, again, just to provide color. So all of this is coming at a colorimetric indicator. In this initial step, you form your partial immune complex of your antigen to the conjugate. And then you have capture antibodies spotted on a nitrocellulose layer. So one of the nice things you can do with paper is to mix and match different materials in this vertical format. So we form a partial immune complex, migrates down to form the full immune complex, and then any residual particles are washed down this wash channel. You peel that open, and then you look for the presence of that blue spot in this case. And so without going into a whole lot of detail, this is a singleplex assay. If you want a multiplex and say look at two assays in parallel, we just add a split layer here. So now we add a sample, it comes in here, splits into two, and then you're running two simultaneous assays in this same concept. The really important thing here is that once you've split your sample, you can optimize these assays completely independently of the other. It seems like a subtle point, but it's actually tremendously important because I can have different dwell times, I have different incubation times, I can have different buffers, different pHs, and all these things are really important in optimizing your signal from the immunoassay. So the ability to do that, it differentiates this quite a bit from lateral flow where everything is running in parallel everything is running in series, and everything has to be happy together. You have to have all the same buffer, the same release agents, all of these things have to play nice together. Here you can optimize very easily. And so we've demonstrated proof of concept this with a C. difficile test. This is one of our corporate partners was interested in looking at this. With C. difficile, you have two different toxins. So you can see here this isn't showing up too well, but you can detect the presence of both toxin A and toxin B, of B only, of A only, and then when you have neither. We've done this with stool samples, so very complex media works nicely in the paper format. We've done pregnancy tests, performed this with real urine, and then these are two assays from the agriculture program, one where we're looking at aflatoxin from a maize wash. So this is a big problem in the developing world, and it's a toxin that really makes people quite sick. And this is one of the bovine serum assays. So we can run this with whole blood and with serum. So that's also a huge advantage that you can just add your drop and the device takes over from there. And we have a number of other assays taking advantage of this architecture, specifically looking at malaria and dengue fever and also a sepsis assay. So I just want to wrap up a little bit with the nucleic acid detection on paper. This is a really, really new area for us and something we're particularly excited about. So when you start off and try to think about all the different sample preparation steps and how am I going to do all this? So look at, each of the things that needs to occur on this device and then, how we can use the paper technology to provide a solution. So sample preparation, this is often done outside of the instrument with pipettes and with vortexers and centrifuges. We can't use any of that. So we need to take advantage of our filtration, our ability to filter materials, our ability to separate and capture the particular nucleic acid that we're looking for, and to be able to wash it. We can do all that in the paper. Reagent storage, again, we can use dry or lyophilized reagents that are embedded in the paper that don't release until it gets wet and you want it to release. On-chip heating, there's a number of low-cost ways that we can do this. There's some groups that have developed exothermic chemistries on chip. It's pretty interesting. But also, it might just be easiest just to use a simple battery that's still very low in cost, still cost pennies per device, and you can just use it and dispose it. We need to resist evaporation, so we've developed materials that can form hermetic seals that we can heat things, for an hour or so and not have any loss due to evaporation. And then ultimately, again, we need to detect this, and this signal can be in the form of a color, or if we're using a small reader, for example, we could even use fluorescence as our detection. So I just want to show a little bit of data. So this is the device design. It's a sliding strip device, we call it. And it's a 3D device, but it has one of the layers that can move. You can perform one function in one position, slide it to the next position, and then perform another function. And so that's our solution to how we can do sample intake. We can wash our sample, we can perform the amplification, and then we can perform the detection by just simply moving this and allowing those serial steps to happen. These are some data from, we're using an amplification chemistry called LAMP, which is similar to PCR, but it doesn't require thermocycling. So you just heat it to one temperature and hold it there for about 45 minutes. And if your target is present, it will amplify. And you can see from here that we can detect down to 100 copies of our target pathogen, which is really, really good. And it's much better than you get with an immunoassay, and it's in the ballpark of what you get with PCR, not quite as good as PCR. And then we can prove that we're getting what we want from these gels. We can take the paper right out of the device and stick it in a gel and run these. And so we're very excited about this because we have a chance to really dramatically reduce the cost of these nucleic acid assays. And this could be very meaningful both in the developed and developing world. We use this term resource poor setting, and that could be, you know, a remote clinic in Africa, but it could also be in an ambulance. It could also be in a doctor's office. So it doesn't always have to be a developing world application for it to be successful. So with that, I'd just like to leave you, to that point, I'd just like to leave you with this slide, which is a nice summary statement of basically that if you have a product that is easy to use, that's low in cost, that provides reliable medical information, that that will not only be something that's tremendously useful for the developing world, but it'll be a pretty good product here in the developed world as well. So this is sort of the foundation of what we're trying to do. So with that, I just want to thank our sponsors shown here, and then thank you for your attention and the organizers again for the opportunity to tell you about what we do.
Well, thank you very much for an excellent presentation. We are open for some questions. Okay, I can kick it off. So it looks like you have all the right components to begin to think about doing paper-based cytometry. Is there any thought about doing cell counting with the technology?
You know, the interesting thing there is cells get hung up in paper. So we've thought a lot about that. There's another technology that we're looking at out of the Whitesides lab that deals with these phase-separated aqueous solutions that have a really interesting ability to separate cells out by density. So that's something we're looking at there. But in terms of doing that in paper, it's complicated by the fact that the cells get hung up in paper.
Yeah, Jim. Go ahead. No. You're next.
How do you control the wicking in the paper when you have the devices in many different types of environmental conditions?
That's great. So the question is, how do you control wicking when you have different environmental conditions like heat and humidity? And so the way we control the wicking actually is by just depositing wax down in the gray scale. So using any illustrator, you can do a shade of gray. And the way the printer works is that for lighter shades of gray, it just deposits less wax. So that's really, you're not dealing with a whole lot of wicking to do that because it's right below where the sample is input. So that will sit there for the programmed amount of time because it's slightly hydrophobic, and it will then begin to wick through. We haven't begun to really look at the effects of humidity in the assay, with the exception of the liver function test. And there we don't see any effect, really. We've tested it all the way from normal humidity to 80, 90% humidity, and it doesn't seem to affect things. But it will affect wicking speed. So I think if we had something with a really long channel and it was dependent on that, then we'd have to think through that. But so far, it doesn't seem to affect things. And we also, the other answer, I guess, would be that everything is laminated and packaged till right before you use it. So assuming that, it's a fairly, it's equilibrated within that package before you add the sample. So we, so the question is, how important is the paper source, in these assays? So we buy all our paper, or the primary paper for the liver function test is from Wattman. So it's this Wattman number one chromatography paper, which is a pure cellulose grade paper that comes nice and packaged. But it is something that we need to worry about, and we'll have to QC before we, make devices and all of that. So we do need to have some traceability for the materials we're using.
Yes.
The question is, could you have an advantage where if you could orient your paper fibers? And I imagine you could dramatically increase your wicking speed if you could do that, and that could be an advantage, particularly when you're dealing with things like blood that are pretty high in viscosity. And a lot of times all this comes down to assay time, and you need to keep that assay time less than 20 minutes is sort of the benchmark. So I think that could be very interesting. We played around a little bit with some woven polyester materials that are very thin, and those can wick pretty quickly. But if you have a particular material, we'd be interested in trying it, sure.
Another question? Okay, one more question.
What kind of? What kind of channel resolution can we achieve? You do get a little bit of spreading when you melt the wax, and that largely depends on the material that you're using. If you use the Wattman chromatography paper, it spreads quite a bit. If you use something like a nitrocellulose membrane, you have almost zero spreading. But I would say it's roughly around 500 microns. We can print channels that are about 500 microns, which isn't a huge deal. As long as we can still be in the right range for sample volume. And remember, ultimately, this has to be something that somebody can see. So we can't get features too small because they won't be able to interpret it. But generally, we deal around the millimeter range.
All right. Well, let's thank the speaker one more time.
Thank you.